As we celebrate the season when we remember the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, we remember that we are celebrating hope. Hope for a world in darkness. Hope for a world that is desperately in need of hope where there is none. And if you recall, we entered the New Testament, the book of Matthew, after 400 years. After the time of Malachi. So between Malachi and Matthew, there was 400 years where the Bible was silent, where there's nothing worth reporting. Little of significance happened. But these 400 years of prophetic silence was similar in many ways to 400 years in the Old Testament, where in Genesis chapter 15, verse 13, Genesis chapter 15, verse 13, then said he to Abram, "Know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. Verse 14, "And also the nation whom they serve I will judge. Afterward they shall come out with great possessions." Abraham was told of 400 years of affliction, of wandering, which will end in a gross darkness for the children of Israel. At the end of that 400 years, Moses came to deliver the children of Israel. And you remember what happened. Pharaoh, in anger, ordered the killing of all the male children of Israel. The male babies were killed just to stop Moses. In a similar way, after the 400 years, you also remember that Herod the Great, the Pharaoh of that time, also ordered the killing of infants. So there are many similarities between these two periods. But the big difference is that the 400 years of darkness, 400 years of wandering for the children of Israel was for Israel. But this 400 years of silence was darkness for the whole world. Darkness, gross darkness for the whole world. And we read of wise men who saw the star in the east, who were looking for hope and were joyful that hope had come into the world. Isaiah chapter 60 verse 2. Isaiah 60 verse 2, the prophet prophesied. He said, "For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee." God's plans are perfectly timed. Christ came exactly on time. The time was prepared for him. And even though there was gross darkness, there was also hope. Everyone was expecting the Savior, particularly these wise men from the east. These wise men, they were like magicians. They were men of knowledge. If you like, they were like the professors in the universities, the citadels of learning in that time. And you can see that they already knew that the world was in trouble. And they had gone into the prophecies to discover, to find out where hope was. And they had found hope in the prophecy of Christ. And they were looking, expecting for Christ to come. And when they saw the star in the east, when they saw the star, even in the east where they were, they followed the star because they were looking for hope. They were looking for something, an answer, where there were no answers. Matthew chapter 2 verse 1, let us read the story as it is narrated in Matthew. Matthew chapter 2 verse 1. "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came." Wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. Verse 2, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." Verse 3, "When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him." Verse 4, "And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born." Verse 5, "So they said to him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet.'" Verse 6, "But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, For out of you shall come out a ruler who will shepherd my people of Israel. 400 years of silence, and then suddenly hope. Let us look at the things that happened that led to the wise men from the east approaching Herod. Let's examine five important transitions that occurred during those 400 years of silence. First, there was a major political transition, major power shifts from power in the hands of the Medo-Persians. Power moved to the Greeks and now to the wicked Romans. The Romans ruled the world at the end of that 400 years, at the end of that period when Christ was just about to be born. And the Romans, they were legendary for their wickedness. They were legendary for the darkness they brought upon the world. These were people who could throw their captives to be eaten by lions for entertainment. These are people who would soak the people they captured in fuel, and they would burn them as torches to light their streets. They had emperors that murdered their mothers, their brothers, just to retain power, and freely engaged in all kinds of extreme moral perversion. They brought in a time of deep darkness, and Herod was put in charge. Herod was a descendant of Esau. He was put in charge of the Jews. Herod was a wicked monster who ordered the murder of infants with ease, just so that he would be able to rule and have assurance of his position. And even today, we can see power is shifting. Power is shifting towards China, towards the East, and a gross darkness is looming. Another shift we see that we had seen in the time of these 400 years of prophetic silence was the end of the Aaronic priesthood. We didn't hear anything about Aaronic priesthood in the New Testament in Matthew. And the Aaronic priesthood that was appointed by God that we saw in Malachi had over time been replaced by a new order of priests, elders and scribes, known only for their corruption. These were like political, clever people with all kinds of alliances with Herod and the rulers. And the Romans manipulated them and used these so-called priests that Christ called hirelings. They were used to control the people on behalf of the Romans. But even they also were expecting a Messiah that would rid them of the Romans. But of course, it was also a time of political darkness. Even today, hirelings abound in the pulpit. The third thing we see in this 400 years of silence, prophetic silence, was there was a lot of intense politics and intense divisions. You suddenly had in Matthew, compared to Malachi, these new leaders that showed up in Israel. We had the Pharisees, we had the Sadducees, we had the Zealots, we had the Essenes, all kinds of groups. The Pharisees were the people who identified with the mercies. They had strict interpretations of the law, but they also accepted the oral traditions, and they codified the oral traditions in the Talmud, and they were the, if you like, the conservatives of that time. And then you had the Sadducees, who did not believe in the oral traditions. They only believed in things that had been written in the law, in the original laws of Moses. So they didn't believe in the resurrection, for example. But they also were more tolerant of the Greek influences. They were more Hellenistic, they were more Greek. You could call them the liberals. They were more open, more trendy, and they were like the friends of the elite. They identified with the elite of the time. And then you had others like the Essenes, who didn't like either the Sadducees or the Pharisees, and so on. And There were all kinds of divisions amongst the children of Israel. Even now, you have a lot of intense political division. You have the conservatives, you have the liberals, you have those who are neither. You have all kinds of divisions, even in the body. It was a time of division, and a lot of these divisions didn't allow people to see clearly. You couldn't see the Savior because they were being manipulated by their divisions. But there were some positive developments that prepared the way for the gospel. There are two I will mention. One was the emergence of Greek as the language, as the common language in the world. There were hundreds of languages before, but the Greeks imposed their language, and there was one language that everybody could easily understand, everybody identified with, and everybody accepted, and that was the Greek language. And that prepared the way for the New Testament to be written in Greek. There was a language in which people could spread and teach the gospel. And that was not just all. The Greeks also paved the way for trade routes across continents, across vast territories, and it was these routes that were now safe for travel that enabled missionaries to travel and take the gospel. So that those were developments. And another development that we see in the 400 years was the emergence of synagogues. These were the beginnings of a congregational type of worship. And we didn't have that in Malachi, but that emerged in the New Testament as people wanted to hear the scriptures read to them. We had synagogues emerged. And even as the church was coming out in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, you see that they borrowed heavily from some of these models of congregational worship, like was found in the synagogue. So what I'm trying to say is God used that 400-year period to prepare for our Lord Jesus Christ. Even as the darkness became extremely dark, there was also preparation for the coming of something new, and that new hope was in Christ. Christ. It was magicians, like I said, wise men from the east, who saw the star. And you can see, if magicians were desperate, if magicians had discovered that nothing else would save the world, something new has to happen, if magicians had given up on Rome, they had seen all the darkness, and they were so troubled by the state of the entire world that they were looking for an answer, you can imagine how dark it must have been. But not all the chief priests and Pharisees and Sadducees were bad. They were also looking for answers because they knew that there was something missing. Remember Nicodemus? He was a Pharisee. He came to Christ. He was a member of the Sanhedrin Council. He came to Christ in the dark of the night. He came in the night, some say, because he didn't want to be seen. Maybe there were other reasons why he came in the night. But you remember in John chapter 3, verse 3, he came in the night and Christ told him, you must be born again. John chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Verse 4, Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Verse 5, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. What does it mean to be born of water? This is not just natural birth. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 26, it says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. To be born by the word, to allow the word of God to wash us, is a kind of rebirth. To have our mind renewed by the word of God, that's a kind of rebirth. But that is not all. We also need to be born of the Spirit. We must be changed inside. Our nature, our very being, is regenerated from inside by God, and sin becomes alien to our new nature. Old things pass away. Even though we may still struggle, we are progressively changed from glory to glory. We cannot enjoy or abide in sin anymore. We are delivered from sin by God. This was the new birth. And this was the message of Christ to Nicodemus the Pharisee, who was looking for an answer. And even the wicked Herod, we know what happened to Herod in the end. Herod the Great, we read, according to historians, he died a horrible death, a painful and debilitating disease came upon him, worms consumed him, and he died rotting. His body was rotting and he was still alive. And he had a son, Herod Antipas, who ruled after him. That is after the Herod that ordered the killing of the children of Israel. Now this Herod Antipas was called the fox by Christ. And you remember that he too was looking for light, because the Bible tells us that he heard John the Baptist and he heard him gladly. So even wicked rulers are looking for answers. They're looking for solutions. Mark chapter 6 verse 20. For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a just man and unholy, and observed him. And when he heard him, he did many things and heard him gladly. So he did some of the things that John the Baptist told him to do, and he heard him gladly. But we know what happened in the end. In the end, he had John the Baptist beheaded. He could not be born again. He did not understand the message of rebirth. And when people come into the congregations without being born again, listening and hearing the messages, enjoying the messages, even enjoying the pastors, enjoying the music, it's a bit dangerous, because Herods are coming into the congregation and the flesh is at war with God. The flesh cannot please God. Eventually, they hear something that would hit them badly. They are challenged and they react in their true nature. And that is the nature of hatred against God. And we know what that meant for John the Baptist. But there was hope, and that hope was Christ. Everyone is looking for hope. Everyone is looking for an answer. What is hope? Hope is the feeling that something good that we want will happen, can happen, or is about to happen. Hope is that the best for us is available and we can enter into it. Everyone is looking for hope. And that is why even magicians from the East came. They were looking for hope. Herod Antipas was looking for hope in talking to John. He was searching for an answer. The wise men from the East were searching for an answer. Christ, hope himself, was the answer. Now, why is Christ the hope of the world? What makes Christ very different from other sources of hope? And we could spend a lot of time talking about Christ as hope, but I would like to just use an example, which we find in Matthew chapter 9, verse 20. This was about a woman who was bleeding. She had an issue of blood that had gone on for 12 years. 12 years of bleeding that had not stopped. She had gone from doctor to doctor. She didn't know what to do. She had spent all her money. She had lost all hope. And then she saw Christ. And that hope that had gone rekindled in her spirit. And what happened? Matthew chapter 9, verse 22. Matthew chapter 9, verse 20. And behold, a woman which was diseased with an issue of blood 12 years came behind him and touched the hem of his garment. Verse 21. For she said within herself, if I may but touch his garment, I shall be made whole. This is what she was confessing in herself. She had that faith that if she touched the garment. Verse 22. But Jesus turned him about, and when he saw her, he said, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith hath made thee whole. And the woman was made whole from that hour. This is a very interesting story, because she had an incurable ailment. She was cured instantly. Her failures over the years were suddenly addressed by the touch of the hem of the garment of a man. And it was amazing, even to many who observed what had happened. And if you read Zechariah chapter 8 verse 23, there had been a prophecy concerning a Jew. Zechariah 8:23, which was being fulfilled, I read, this is what the Lord Almighty says, in those days 10 people from all languages and nations will take firm hold of one Jew by the hem of his robe and say, let us go with you, because we have heard that God is with you. Remember, people from all languages, from all over the world, they will come and they will take firm hold of the Jew by the hem of his robe. Now, what does this mean as we begin to see the fulfillment of this prophecy in Christ? In Matthew chapter 14, there was another healing which involved the hem of the garment of Christ. And this second healing, it was even more remarkable in that everyone who was able to touch the hem of Christ's garment was healed. Matthew chapter 14, verses 34 to 36. Let me read from 34. And when they were gone over, they came into the land of Gennesaret. And when the men of that place had knowledge of him, they sent out into all that country round about and brought unto him all that were diseased. They brought all that were diseased. Verse 36. And besought him that he might only touch the hem of his garment. And listen, and as many as touched were made perfectly whole. As many as touched were made not just whole. The Bible says perfectly whole. What does this mean? What is the importance of the hem of the garment of Christ? Can we just touch the garment of a pastor or a minister somewhere and expect healing? I think there is much more to this issue of the hem of Christ's garment that we can look further into. Remember, Christ is our high priest. Read that in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. And God had ordained that the high priest would have a garment, would have a robe, and at the fringes of this robe there will be a special hem. And if you read Exodus chapter 28, verse 33, you understand how this hem was supposed to have been put together. Verse 33, Exodus 28. You shall make on it hem, pomegranates, those are fruits, pomegranates of blue and purple and scarlet material all around on its hem, and bells of gold between them all around. Verse 34, a golden bell and a pomegranate, a golden bell and a pomegranate all around on the hem of the robe. Verse 35, it shall be on Aaron when he ministers, and its tinkling shall be heard when he enters and leaves the holy place before the Lord, so that he will not die. Now, the pomegranates were of three colors, blue, purple, and scarlet. There's a lot we can talk about the hem, but let me just talk about three important things that makes the healing, the hope that we have in Christ, extremely unique and very different from any other kind of hope. There are three important issues around wholeness that we can talk about. But let's look first at the color. The colors were blue, purple, and scarlet. Colors of the fruits were blue, purple, and scarlet. Blue, purple, and scarlet speaks of abundance, speaks of life, speaks of royalty, speaks of wealth, speaks of healing. Those colors, blue, purple, speaks of abundance. And Christ is a complete package. Touching Christ is touching a complete package of wellness, of goodness, and of abundance. Imagine a doctor that is not just curing your headaches, but gives you a blank check, gives you a new regimen of holiness, a new regimen of purity, a new way of life. And these colors, these fruits that came from these colors, you could see that they had an important significance. The same thing with Christ. Touching Christ is touching a different type of life. But apart from that, there are other important things that we can see about the hem of the garment. The golden bell. Remember what the bell was for. The priests could go into the presence, into the Holy of Holies, the high priest, and the bell would sound as they went into the Holy of Holies. And if they were still alive, because there were times when maybe because they were not properly prepared or something had gone wrong, they would be killed in the presence of God. But when the sound was there, it would show that they were alive, because you could hear the tinkling of the golden bells. And when the children of Israel heard the bell tinkling, they knew that there was someone interceding, someone alive interceding for them. The same way when we know that Christ is alive, when we have the assurance that Christ is alive interceding for us, that assurance that it is like having a surgeon living with us. You know, if a surgeon is living with you, you are less worried about illness, you're less worried about medical issues, because you know that the surgeon is there with you. If a mighty warrior is living with you, you are less worried about being attacked by enemies, because the mighty warrior is living with you. The assurance that he's alive tells us, gives us that confidence, gives us that peace, gives us that different wholeness, that different confidence. So when we touch the hem, we touch that assurance that Christ lives, and because he lives, disease, corruption cannot abide with us. Because he is with us, evil has to flee from us. The final thing I will talk about in talking about the hem was, look at those fruits, the pomegranates. Remember in John chapter 10, verse 10, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came, that is Christ, that they might have life, they may have life and have it abundantly. There is a tree that was mentioned in the Bible that has fruits that gives life, and that is the tree of life. You see that in Genesis. And remember in Genesis chapter 2, verse 9, we are told in the Garden of Eden there were two trees, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, representing life independent of Christ, that would lead to sin, would lead to a curse, and would ultimately lead to death. Just as every other doctor's hope, every other doctor's healing, every other magician's healing, every other source of health, your good exercises, good advice you are taking from your body, eating well, naturally healing, even going to the witch doctor and seeking healing from all kinds of potions, even if they can give you some relief, it will ultimately lead to death. The patient, even if he lives 100 years, he will ultimately die. But there's another tree, the tree of life. We read in Genesis chapter 3, verse 22, that this tree will allow whoever eats of its fruit to live forever. Genesis 3, verse 22. And the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. If you read Revelation 22, you also read about this tree of life. Now, Christ is the tree of life. The wholeness in Christ, when we touch his fruits, when we eat of Christ, eat of his word, when we touch of him, we enter into not just life or healing for our physical body, just like a doctor can make us well, but we enter into a life that will extend beyond death. A life that will conquer death, that will enable us to say, death, where is your sting? There is no other source of healing that gives us this assurance. Doctors have been researching how to make man live forever. All kinds of exercises, all kinds of drugs, magicians have been looking for the answer. They will never find it, because it is only in Christ that we have the promise of eternal life. It is only in Christ that we have a promise that we will conquer death, will be raised incorruptible someday, and some will not even see death. They will be taken up with Christ at the time when Christ returns. This is awesome. But this is the hope that we have. This is what makes healing in Christ, wholeness in Christ, vastly different from any other wholeness. Let me summarize. We are approaching a season where we remember Christ. Remember that he came 2,000 years ago. Remember that he came to bring hope to the world, to those who would receive him. Remember that magicians, rulers, simple men, Pharisees, Sadducees, they were all looking for hope, all looking for light to disperse the darkness, the political darkness, the spiritual darkness, the physical darkness. Christ was that light. They must be born again. And if you're not born again, if you're not born of the water and of the word, born of the spirit, if you're not born anew, born afresh, remember, birth is something that you know. You're either born again, you are not born. If you have not been born again, then you are eating the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the tree that leads eventually to death. And remember, the hope in Christ is like no other. It's a complete package. That is why all that touched the hem of the garment of Christ, all, they were made perfectly whole, perfectly whole. It's a complete package of perfection. It's a complete package of wholeness. It is the hope of divine health, not needing drugs, living without any medicine. It's the hope of abundant life, living well. It's the hope of eternal life, conquering death. It is the hope of having the abiding presence of God, knowing that God is with us, God is for us, God is in us. And when God is for us, who or what can be against us? I pray you will not be caught only by the traditions of Christmas cards, trees, decorations, and shopping in this time when we remember the hope of the world. I hope you will come to Christ. If you have not given your life, you have not surrendered your life, you haven't been born again, come to Him and by faith receive Him into your life as your Savior. I hope you will enter into this experience touching the wholeness that is in Christ, that tree of life, touching that abundance that extends into eternity. Also remember, Christ said He would come again. Remember, I spoke about Greek becoming the common language at the end of the first 400, at the end of that second 400 years of silence between Malachi and Matthew. Similarly, we now have the new language, digital revolution, new things that are in the world, all kinds of global connectivity that allows the gospel to spread, that allows us to preach the gospel, for example, as I'm speaking here, whether on Facebook or on any other social media package, people all over the world can hear the message, can be touched by Christ. Now, this is preparing us for the second coming, when the Bible says the gospel will reach all the corners of the earth. And our role is to do that work of spreading the gospel, to use all these tools to let everyone hear that Christ indeed has come. And I pray that as you hear, the Holy Spirit will help and you will respond to the gospel. Do not be fooled by the silence, because some may say, well, is He really coming again? As they may have said, after 400 years of silence before Moses, was there any hope? But Moses came and there was hope, and the children of Israel were delivered. Even in the darkness that came with Rome, many must have wondered, is there any hope? Christ came, and the world had hope, a new hope, an eternal hope in Christ. The same way people may be saying, is Christ coming again? Let me assure you that He is. He will return just exactly as He has promised at the appointed time. My prayer is that the eternal hope that is Christ will manifest in eternal life and complete victories for you. I pray that when He returns, you will not be found wanting, you will not be found unprepared. Have a wonderful season of celebrating Christ the Savior, Christ the hope of mankind. God bless you.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, or hear those angel voices anoint divine. Night when Christ was born, a night divine, a night divine. Truly He taught us to love one another. Father, His law is love, and His gospel is peace. Chains shall He break, for the slave is our brother, and in His name shall oppression cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise His holy name. Christ is the Lord, our praise His name forever, His power and evermore proclaim His power and glory, evermore, evermore proclaim and then hear the angel voices. Oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born.
Christ is the hope of the world. Christ is the hope of wholeness, of perfection. I'm praying for someone, even as you've listened to this message, that I don't know what you're going through, but there is a wholeness that is coming into your life as you touch Christ. Not me, touch Christ. As you receive Him, as you pray to Him, as you say to Him, come into my life, make me whole. Make me whole in my body. Make me whole in my spirit. Make me whole in my soul. Make me whole. And as you say that prayer, Lord Jesus, come into my life and make me whole, you shall receive a fresh healing. And not just the healing from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but healing from the tree of life. Healing from the tree of life. A perfect healing that will extend not just into this time, but even into eternity. A perfect healing that will affect your body, affect your soul, affect your spirit, affect your thinking, affect your mind, that would renew your mind. A perfect healing that would make you dependent on Christ, dependent on His Spirit, and live by His Spirit, be led by the Holy Spirit on a day-by-day basis. As we celebrate Christ in this season, remember there is a wholeness that is different. Remember, there is a healing, there is a hope that is different. Remember the difference between the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Healing that comes from doctors, from exercise, from injections, from good diet and all the citadels of learning. And remember the difference between that and healing that comes from God. Eternal healing that comes from God. Never forget wise men. These wise men were the professors. They had seen that all that man has to offer, all that knowledge, education, magic, whatever it is we can get from the tree of knowledge of good and evil has to offer, could not address the issues of the world. It was still darkness. And even today, all we see is still the same darkness, except we accept Christ. Ask Christ to come into your life and feel the difference. I pray that the healing you have received will be permanent. I pray that the healing you have received will be complete. I pray that the healing you have received will be total and will be all round. Extend to your family, extend to your home, extend to whatever situations that you are bringing before God in your prayers. And all glory, all the honor will go to Christ. Most importantly, you will be prepared for Christ when he comes again, when he returns for the saints. God bless you.
Kushoro.